Hi everyone, welcome to this new tutorial. Today we'll be looking at the new Path Tracer feature that has been just added in Twinmotion 2022. The Path Tracer is a DXR-accelerated, physically accurate, progressive rendering mode that can be enabled in the viewport with just a single button. This enables you to create final pixel imagery comparable to offline renderings, including compromise-free global illumination, physically correct refraction, super-sampled anti-aliasing, and much more. Let's have a look at how it works. So here in the Twinmotion user interface, you may see that there is a new icon, which is the Path Tracer icon. You can also press R on your keyboard to turn it on. When you press this option, as you can see, it starts to calculate. You see all those pixels. It starts to generate that image, to calculate it multiple times. It starts to refine it. And as you can see here, there is also this progress bar that tells you the length of basically the rendering time of that specific frame you are currently in. And as you can see here, when the progress bar reaches the end, we have a denoiser, which is an AI tool that will just smooth all the pixels that you add on screen. Let's have a look at the dock specific to the Path Tracer. It's located here in the settings renderer. Here you have a couple of options. First thing I'm going to do is disable the denoiser. As you can see here, it will start again to recalculate that image. I'm going to leave that until the end of that progress bar, just to show you how it looks without denoiser. And that's it. Here, the image stopped its calculation, and as you can see, you still have a lot of pixels on the screen. This is where the AI denoiser comes really helpful, is that it takes all those information, all those different pixels, and just mix and match them together to just remove that noisy aspect. So for now, I'm going to leave the denoiser off and show you some of the other options. The sample per pixel is probably the most useful one. If you set up a really small value, it will just calculate that image, that number of samples. So for example, let's leave it at 2 and press enter. Here it will calculate basically the image 2 times and it will stop the calculation. You can press the denoiser and here, same thing, it will calculate the image 2 times and it will enable the denoiser, and as you can see here, I have a result really quickly. I can right away have a better comprehension of the lighting in my scene with just a couple of seconds. So for example, here I can disable the Path Tracer, I can navigate in my scene somewhere like closer to that part, and I can re-enable my Path Tracer, and as you can see here, with a just low number of samples, I have a pretty good indication of the lighting. Also, I can of course use all the Twinmotion features, like for example here, the time of day. So let's actually change the time of day and see if we can have some sun coming inside the project from a different angle. And here I will just re-enable the Path Tracer. And as you can see right now, it's pretty dark, so maybe what I can do is place a light in the place of my window in front of me. So let me disable the Path Tracer. I'm going to grab a light, probably an area light. I'm going to place it over here, just turn in that direction 90 degrees. Just going to place that somewhat in the middle of my window. I can also change the setting to match actually the size of my window. So probably something like, yeah, let's 2.4, 2 and 4. Let's enable the shadow. And same thing over here. I'm just going to press R to calculate the Path Tracer. As you can see here, the shadows are way smoother compared to the rasterized mode, which is the real-time inside Twinmotion viewport. Here we have some shadows that are really sharp, but when I press R, the shadows are perfectly smooth. This is where the Path Tracer is also really helpful, is having really nice shadows. Let's come back to our original seal, so I'm going to remove that area light, going to turn the sun so it comes again a bit more inside my project, my house. And I will come back to my setting dog. If by default I enter the renderer dock and the path tracer is not enabled, it will be actually the first option to turn it on. When you turn that option on, the option appears. The number of bounds defined, the number of of bounds each ray will go through until it stops. So for example here, if I set up just, let's say, one bounce, as you can see here, I don't have a lot of lighting information. So the sun, when it comes in, it doesn't bounce on my ceiling. If I set up two bounces, I have a first bounce, so the light comes in, it bounces on my floor and bounces back at my ceiling. Same thing for that mirror, as you can see here on the right. The ray coming from the camera bounces on the mirror and give the information on the back, but it's pretty fast, that's true, but the lighting is not perfect. So what I like to do is use a number of bounds about 8. As you can see, it's also quite fast. The time difference between 2 and 8 bounds is not that big. It's really the number of samples that play a big role in the rendering time of your image. When working in the viewport, what I like to do is either work in low or medium. Low or medium gives you a pretty quick look at how the final image will look like, but still it's a bit blurry, it's a bit, you have some blobs of light, of leaking. For example, if you look at the lighting, it's not that perfect. But in the viewport, when you are navigating, when you are prototyping and changing material, it's perfect. Also, those settings, you can customize it. Here, the 8 number is the number of samples. So when you switch from low to medium, it will switch automatically the number of samples. But you can also customize those presets. To customize those presets, you will click on that burger menu over here, click on Preference. And here you have the path tracer settings. And here you can customize the number of samples and the number of bounds for each of the presets, low, medium, and high. Right now I am using those settings. For low I am at 8 samples, medium is 64, and high preset, which is usually the preset I'm using when I'm exporting images, I'm set it up at 512. So that's my settings. But feel free to use the one that works the best for you. Let's now have a look at the media. When you want to create an image, let's come to the doc image, I will click on the plus to create a new image. By default, this image is not using the path tracer. If you want to enable the path tracer, you will just simply need to click on the path tracer button on. And it affects automatically the image you are in. So as you can see here, you have this new icon that just appear, and this icon say that this image is using the path tracer. If I click on the plus button to create a new image, and if I disable the path tracer, it will disable the path tracer only on that specific image. That one will remain with the path tracer settings. Here, if I'm changing the preset, if I'm switching from low to medium to high, it will affect the settings of that image. So let's come to the more of that specific image, open the renderer dock, and here if I switch from low or switch to high, as you can see, it changed the value here in my dock. So it's a quick way to work actually. Basically, when I'm doing my image, when I'm still refining my project, when I'm still changing light parameter, changing materials, I'm using the low quality. But when I want to export my image, I'm just selecting that image in the dock. I will go to that icon and then will click here and switch to high, switching that image to the highest quality. Let's have a look at some of the other options. Here I switch to the bathroom of my house. I'm going to press R to re-enable the path tracer. As you can see here, we have some pretty bright dot. That is the firefly that you can see in the dock over here. The path tracer simulates light by randomly tracing a ray according to material properties. when bright areas of the scene have a low probability of being discovered, the resulting sample can become excessively bright, creating specks of light or fireflies that appear and disappear within the frame. Past tracing attempt to minimize the most common source of these effects, but they can still occur in some scenarios. So here in my case, if I want to lower the fireflies, what I can do is just basically play with this slider to lower the brightness of those white and bright dots. Next is the emissive option. The emissive will define if glowing material affect your scene. So to do that, let me disable the path tracer. What I will do is just, for example, select a box, place that box inside my scene. Maybe it's just like some kind of glowing light. On that box, what I will do is select a material, going to the bottom to the neon, and I will drag and drop that neon material onto that box, just lowering a bit the intensity of the box, of the glow. So what I will do now is come back, enter the more renderer, I will turn on the path tracer, and as you can see here, that box, that glowing material is actually emitting some light. If I disable this option, this box will just glow and won't emit any lighting. So you can turn that option on and off inside the dock. Finally, the last option is the aliasing filtering. To better show you that, I exported two images. And I'm going to zoom in inside those images. This option will control if your image is more sharp or more smooth. Lower value will be sharp, while larger value will get you a softer result, as you can see here. The path tracer works perfectly for images with both denoiser on and off. However, the denoiser does not currently guarantee temporal consistency, especially for interior rendering. So if you are exporting a video and you see some flickering in it, it's because of the denoiser. Right now, each frame are denoised on its own, without looking at the surrounding frames, thus far creating these artifacts. Relatively high samples are required for stable output, but you can also export a video with denoiser off, and use a third-party tool to denoise the video in post-production. Before ending that video, I wanted to cover the minimum requirements to run Twinmotion and to run that new feature, the Path Tracer. You will need a DXR-capable card. If you want to learn more, I will place a link in the description of that video that will point you toward that Path Tracer requirement page on our support website, where we detail all the relevant information to check if your GPU is capable of running Twinmotion and the Path Tracer. And that's it for this video. Thank you everyone for joining me. Leave us some comments about what you will need to see in the next Twinmotion tutorial, and see you for the next one. Bye everyone.